What is it called pre-London?
So you didn't actually start out to become a clothing brand?
No, God, I never went to start a clothing brand.
I didn't know that.
What? Got the money off my credit card into my bank and then wired the money to her, £7,500. It was in the January. I went to bed and I started panicking. So I went from jeans, T-shirts, to then making my own vests. Oh, to then, I suppose, the biggest thing that happened after then, we had Foot Asylum reach out to us. Probably 200 stores at one point. We never went further than the UK and Ireland, which I just couldn't handle, to be fair.
Can I ask what it turned over in the first year?
Yo, Curtis.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Convos with Curtis. If you haven't already, please go and subscribe to the channel and like this video because we've got an absolute cracker today. I'm very interested to have this conversation with Ash, who is the owner of the brand Pre-London. So first of all, thank you for joining me today. I've been buzzing to have this conversation because for people that watch my podcast, they know I love to pick people's brains that have got like successful businesses.
Yeah.
So thanks for coming down, first of all.
Nah, no problem, Curtis. I think it's been probably 5 times in the making, hasn't it? I've cancelled a few times and we haven't met up and stuff like that. No, so thanks for having me down here.
Thank you for coming, bro. Before we get into the journey of Pre-London and what the brand is and how successful it's been, I'd like to just go back and get your early years
of
what you was like growing up and what growing up was like for you in terms of family, school and that kind of stuff.
Yeah, fine. God, I was born in Chelmsley Wood.
Lovely.
Probably only there, I think, maybe 1 year. Then moved to Small Heath, when I was about one or two. Lived in Small Heath for 21 years, believe it or not. I know, not many.
21 years.
Yeah, went to St. Bernadette's School, then went straight into Holy Trinity School. Bit of a mixed bag at home, to be fair, because my mum and dad split up when I was one.
Mm-hmm. Is that why you moved?
Probably not. I'd say it was probably that was probably the reason. I never really picked into it at the time, but then from that, I lived with my mum and stepdad till probably about the age of 10. Wasn't great, to be fair. Didn't have a great upbringing on that side of it. And then I ended up going and living with my grandparents from about the age of 10. My nan and granddad, who were from Ireland and came to this country back in the 40s. So, yeah, my nan and granddad brought me up, went to Holy Trinity School. Bit of a mixed bag, obviously, living with your grandparents. It wasn't the easiest, I say, with not having, obviously, your mum and dad there for you all the time. But my nan was brilliant. My nan was sort of like the person that I looked up to and guided me. And I think if it weren't for her, I probably wouldn't be sitting here in the position that I am today, if I'm honest with you. She inspired me, even though I didn't do great at school. I was really shit, to be fair. probably because I went to Holy Trinity School. I don't think anyone done any good from there.
Find? Most people that have built big, successful brands always did shit at school.
Oh, do you know what?
But they're somewhere between a little bit of ADHD or something like that. And that, I think, as I'm working it out now, things like ADHD are the reason that you can't pay attention in school.
Yeah.
But it's also giving you creative genius at the same time.
Do you know what? I was always a bit of the joker at school. I think because I wasn't that, not clever. My concentration levels were never there for some reason. I used to get bored, but everyone used to piss about it in our school, to be fair. So it was hard to even sort of learn. But I think, I messed about. I used to be a bit of the joker half the time. And concentration levels weren't ever there. And I think I just struggled. I don't know if it was a mixture of my background and stuff, but I struggled concentrating at school all the time. And I do regret it. And I came out of school with no GCSEs, which isn't the best way. But, as you say, I've obviously got to where I've got to. And I've worked with people that have been to, done really well at school, been to university. But that doesn't make them the most cleverest person in the world. And actually, some of those people end up just getting good jobs, where I think when you don't have that academic background, you don't have those qualifications to go and get a great job, you have to think of ways, how am I going to make money? What can I do to actually improve my life. Yeah, I messed up when I was younger, but what can I do now to try and change those things? You can't really start going back and start learning maths and English again, can you? So,
well, you could, but yeah, by that time you can count and speak. So,
yeah, exactly.
Do you know what I mean? I think like it's a lot of the kids in school that don't do well.
Yeah,
and you see them now, and you think, you know, weren't expecting you to do so well for yourself. Do you know what I mean? And then I always think like there was clever kids in my year that were getting A stars.
Yeah.
And they ended up with, this is not to spite anybody, but they ended up with like normal jobs.
Yeah.
And I think like, does it matter that much?
Honestly, I don't think it does. And I've got two.
We're good.
I thought we were off it. I've got two boys and... I've said to both of them, obviously my one son's 21 now, I said to both of them, do you know what? It's not the be all and end all. Mm-hmm. Don't worry about it. Don't put yourself under that much stress. You know, fair play. My oldest lad, he has done really well at school. I don't know where he got it from because it can't be me or his mum, but he went on and passed his A-levels and done everything that me and her never did. So, but yeah, I've seen other lads who were clever at school and just unemployed. I've seen other lads who obviously did do crap at school, and gone on to do a lot better and started obviously businesses. But I think it's down to the individual. I think it's down to yourself and your drive and what you want out of life. And a lot, you know, and I don't think it comes down to education or even lack of it half the time. It depends on what you want out of life, I think.
What did you want out of life?
What did I want? I always wanted to buy my own house. I always wanted to be successful. I always wanted to drive a really nice car.
Well, you're doing that now.
Do you know what? I'll be honest with you. I thought if I did all those three things or even more, I would be content. I'd be happy. Does it buy you happiness? I think when you set goals and you hit them, you're there going, what the hell am I going to do now? And I think sometimes it's sort of having that sort of dream keeps the fire in your belly, where when you hit the dreams or hit the goals, you sort of can lose then going, well, what am I going to do here now? Well, actually, that car is still the same as driving that other car. Mm-hmm. Is it going to change? You know.
It just goes a little bit faster.
Yeah, it do, yeah,
and
of course.
And you can't use it for that reason anyway. So,
no.
Well.
But then, and I think to yourself then, you have to just sort of start reevaluating life. But yeah, I think you've got to have dreams and you've got to have goals and you know. But that's what I always wanted to do. And I always thought, even though I was thick and I had to work my way up in different jobs, I always thought in my head, Ash, you know, you're going to do that. And I kept always thinking about it. I kept always dreaming about it. And do you know what? Many times I should have given up. Many times I could have easily gone, you just need to be content. But I was just never content. I was never content for my two boys either. I was never content to letting them just, or providing with them the things that sort of, providing them with the things that I never had either. And I thought, do you know what, Ash? You know, you never had a dad in your life. It's up to you to try and make that change for them, to try and help them. And I think that's what probably drove me on more, of me not having that support in the background, in the past, growing up. And I think as a child, you do need that. And kids, you know, need that support. And a lot of kids don't have it. And I think that's why a lot of kids got off the rails. A lot of kids lose their head. A lot of kids can't focus on school education, on bettering themselves, because they don't believe that anyone feels like they should be doing better. Because of, I think it comes down to parenting. I do believe it.
I was just going to say the reason.
I know we're going off it.
We've got all the time in the world. And like I said, I'm interested to really pick your brain. So
yeah.
Going back to the point, you said that your kids did do well at school, whereas you never. And I'm just validating your point there, where you said you wanted for them what you never had.
Yeah.
Which is probably why your kids did do well in school, because you was a good parent to them, well, both of you, and you made sure that they did do well.
I think it's having a settled upbringing as well is important, isn't it? Mm. You know, home life, when there's a lot of distractions going on at home and kids, you know, can't settle. And I think that just helps them really, where it puts them at ease when, you know, if everything's going hunky-dory at home, it's sound then for you to go to school and just learn, isn't it? Where, yeah, I probably didn't have that as much, even though I had my nan and granddad who were fantastic to me and brought me up. But, you know, it's not a place where you want to be as a child sometimes. You do just want to be with your mum and dad kind of thing, so.
Okay, let's fast forward to... Yeah. leaving secondary school.
Yeah.
So you've left secondary school.
Yeah.
As you've already clarified, you got no GCSEs.
No.
Where are you going there?
I didn't have a clue. Do you know what? I've done what most lads my age did. Applied for an apprenticeship at the Land Rover.
Sorted.
That'll yeah. I applied for that. Was unsuccessful because I could never pass any of the tests.
Yeah.
Because I could never pass a test. So I failed all the tests. I then went on to Solihull College to study engineering. I don't know why. I think it was just... But this is back in 96 now. So I went to study...
Showing your age there.
I know, yeah. I'm getting... feel really old. Went to Solihull College, studied engineering. Hated it. But you know what? We went there. It was a good group of lads. And we played football at lunchtime. And I was buzzing. And that's all I went to do. And like, I'll be honest with you. Yeah, played football at lunchtime. And then while the lessons were going on, I was doing an intermediate GMVQ. I don't even know if there's even one of them about now. And then we just all got together. And we sort of helped each other out on doing the course. I passed it. And then what else did I want to do? I didn't have a clue. I went on to do the advanced, which was it's like A-level, which was above me, really. I got onto it, couldn't concentrate on it, didn't have a clue what was going on. Copied half the time to try and get through it, but we were still kicking football on a lunchtime. And then obviously we got to 17, 18, and we were down the boozer, weren't we? So it was happy day. So I think looking back, it was just more of a social aspect for me then, just getting out and about and meeting people, and it was a good group of friends. And then from the back of that... there was an apprenticeship come up with ADT. Don't know if you know the fire alarms and security, CCTV. I applied for it and I managed to get through and jumped on that for about a year as an apprentice. Enjoyed it. It was a good laugh, to be fair. And then off the back of that, everyone at ADT and the engineer said to me, you've got to be an electrician. I was still fumbling my way through life here. I was 18, still didn't have no clue what I wanted to do. And I was like, all right, then, because more money in electrics. I applied for electrical apprenticeship, got into that, ended up going in as an apprentice with, it was a firm in Small Leaf, actually. I can't think of the name now. Bloody hell, Walter J. Parsons. And then I was on day release at Garrett's Green College with a load of electricians, and that was back to having a
Garrett's Green College.
Yeah, and we used
That's gone now, isn't it?
Yeah, it's gone.
Been knocked down.
And like... I used to have such a laugh with some lads from Chardin, a different place. And again, we had a good sort of group of friends. And
loads of football at lunchtime.
No, it was straight over. What was it? What was the pub? There was the pub across the road from Garrett's Green.
Oh,
it was
just Chestnuts.
Straight, yeah, the Chestnuts were straight that's gone in there. As well. Yeah, that's gone.
It's the island before the Radleys.
Yeah, that was it. So it was just a good group of lads. And I'd done that for a couple of years. But I'm going to be honest with you. I had a fallout with one of the electricians in... I was a bit of an idiot back then as well because I'd fallen into following the blues.
Right.
And I was a bit sort of going down a bit of the wrong path.
I'll tell you who I support then.
No, I know, Villa. Well, I was, do you know what, Curtis? I was going down a bit of the wrong path. I was sort of mixing with the wrong people down the football, doing everything that you shouldn't do. And then I used to think I was the Johnny Bigsbuds going into work as an apprentice electrician. I had a fallout with one of the electricians there. And me and him, I ended up having a fight and ended up hitting the electrician. I ended up getting the sack. And I was like, what was it, 19, 20? Yeah. I got the sack, so I lost my apprenticeship. So, yeah, it was a bit of a...
And it's funny how things happen, though, because you could have been stuck in that.
Oh, I know.
Not that it would have been a bad trade, because a spark is a really good trade to have, but obviously you've made a massive success now. So
I know.
Maybe if you had not given one, you'd have been stuck there that whole time. And pre-London wouldn't have existed.
Well, this is it. I always think things happen for a reason, and I believe that. And I think you go through this lot. I do think sometimes it's planned out for you, and you can obviously make as many opportunities as you can, but I think if it's going to happen, it does happen. I know they say you've got to create your own sort of opportunities, but I do think sometimes, you know what, things happen for a reason.
I think opportunities present themselves and it's up to you whether you take them or not.
That's
what I think.
Yeah.
I've always thought that. Like, I've done loads of different things through the years and I've, like, every time something goes wrong, something else seems to work itself out I'm looking for it.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
If I'm actively working, I'm actively putting the graft in, I'm actively looking for it,
yeah,
something will always give.
Yeah.
That's what I think anyway.
Yeah.
Touch wood. Hope things don't go wrong now.
No, I think I've done my growing up then. Looking back, even talking about it now, you've made me think about obviously a lot of things that have gone on and, Yeah, I just growing up, like most lads at 19 years of age, you haven't grown up. When you're in your 20s, you haven't grown up. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't care if people say to me, going, oh, I want to do this, and they're 16. I don't think you know.
No, you don't.
And I think you go through life at different stages in life going, don't want to do this anymore. Maybe I want to do that. And
I'm 30 years old, and I think that now.
I still think it, Curtis. I'm always, after so many years, I'm thinking, do I want to do this again? Do I want to do something else? You're only here. Do you know what my nan said to me? Ash, you're only here once. If you're not happy, leave it, change it, do it. You're only here once. So just make sure you're happy, make sure you enjoy life. And if you're not, change it. And I think that's what I've sort of gone through, sort of that motto going, don't like this anymore. You know, you've got to change it.
What is happiness to you? What defines happiness?
Oh, what is happiness? If I suppose happiness for me now is I bought the house that I could never dream of. I live in an area that I could never dream of. No way could I dream of. And yeah, I just feel where we live that my kids are safe and just content and I'm happy. That's probably happiness for me now. It's not cars. It's not any of that stuff. It's just, yeah.
You can give me your cars then. We'll have them, won't we?
Yeah. Cars come and go, though.
No, of course
they
do. Yeah. Of course they do. I wanted to ask you that because sometimes we don't stop to think that. Actually makes me happy? What am I most happy with? And that's why I wanted to ask you that question.
Do you know what? Yeah. I have my brother asking me that going, are you happy? Are you really happy? And I'm not. Then sometimes I think to myself, what is happiness? Mm. What is it? What is actually happiness? But the things that I've been successful, we've been able to obviously buy through the business. You know, my home, I realise, is a big, big thing. And I think as you're growing up, especially if you've got children, it plays a big part.
Of course.
Because I know what it was like getting the bus down them dodgy sides, getting the bus back and all that kind of thing. Do you know what I mean? And to go through all the craziness, you know, of growing up, and you think, and it's got worse now. Do you know what I mean? I just think it's got, especially Birmingham, it's got so sad.
Terrible.
It's so bad. Terrible. It really pisses me off that we've, like, I don't want to sort of
touch on it.
All that knife crime, kids, this, that, you know, it shouldn't be happening, should it?
No.
And I was thinking,
it's a joke.
Yeah, it's so bad.
And the people in power are putting their energy into the wrong places here.
Mm. Because I feel Birmingham's neglected. It always has been.
Yeah.
I think after London, you know, I think Manchester obviously gets a better look in. Every other city gets a better look in than Birmingham. Mm-hmm. The whole system, even the schools, everything. You know, all the schools have got worse. There's no schools that are decent. My school was shit back in 96, and I can't imagine what it's like now.
Yeah, probably way worse.
And how many kids come out of an education, how many kids, you know, all that kind of thing, but I don't know. I just think it's just, you know, I lived in Small East 21 years. I feel like I'm sound walking around there, but it's so, everywhere these.
I don't think you're sound walking anywhere.
Anywhere,
now.
This is it now, this is what I mean. I don't think it's sound anywhere in Brum.
Okay, if we go back to when we was a little bit younger, yeah, obviously you're a little bit older than me, but... When we used to walk around as kids, you might have some people you didn't get on with.
Yeah.
But other than that, everyone was a familiar face.
Yeah.
You knew everybody. That's him from over there, or they go to that school, or...
Yeah, yeah.
Now, I feel like nobody knows anybody.
No. I think because, I don't know about you, but back when I was younger, we used to be out all the time. We'd be in the park, we'd be out on the street, we'd be always out, where a lot of these kids now are not out, they're in the house... on social media or gaming, aren't they? Like, my kids don't go out. Not many kids seem to go out anymore, do they? How many kids are out on a bike?
Would you want your kids out now?
Well, that's the problem now. It's that people don't want their kids out.
And then all they do is use these to cause problems for each other.
And I think they're seeing so much on social media, and then there's all this, like, there's all this greed. Everyone wants everything now, don't they? Mm. Everyone wants it now. Everyone wants it quick. Mm. No one wants to work for anything.
No, it's true.
Everyone wants a quick life. And I was saying this to my wife, driving over, going, in Birmingham, how many people want money quick?
Everybody. You know,
but then how many opportunities is there in Brum? Not that many. Land Rover's still on the main one.
It really is. Like
yeah.
I worked there for 4 years.
Everyone I speak to, even people that I know down the football, I go, where do you work? Land Rover.
Everyone does. Because it's stable.
My nephew, Land Rover. My brother-in-law, everyone. Yeah. My uncle used to work at Land Rover. It's like, everyone's Land Rover. But it's sad, though, isn't it?
Yeah, so that's why many people that I know from Land Rover.
Yeah. But this is it. When you go to Manchester, you know, what fashion that I was in, that massive pub for it. Birmingham's dead for a lot of things. Mm. I know there's certain, you know, businesses and brands that have done really well and stuff like that, but, you know, it's not the hub. It's not the place where, you know, people are aspiring to work. Because I even struggled to recruit people when it was always, I was sort of working with people that was based up north because that's where the hotbed is for a lot of it is, where... What is there in Brum? I don't know.
That's why a lot of musicians go to London and places like that, because there's just nothing here in Brum for them either.
Well, I was just going to say, if we go back to 2016 to 2020, Birmingham was a hotspot for everything, I believe. Mm. Music, definitely. Nightlife was popping.
Yeah.
And then now...
Pre-COVID.
Literally.
Nightlife.
It was a complete different world.
Oh, do you know what? I had some good times out in Brum. No, barely step foot out of there.
Well,
you barely see me in Birmingham now. I used to be always out on a weekend in Brum.
Our spot would be Arcadian.
Yeah.
Now, going back to pre-COVID and a few years before that, you'd have 7 or 8 active clubs that were full 3 nights a week.
Yeah.
If you go there now, on a Saturday, you might find 1 or 2 that are full.
I know.
So it's just declined.
It's just gone so downhill, hasn't it?
Yeah. We're going off on a right tangent. I know, we're going massive. But it's good, though, because you're talking about relevant points. And, as someone that's come from Birmingham and done well for yourself, I think a lot of people needs to hear that.
Yeah, and I think a lot of people don't know that. And I think, obviously, for me, I know, obviously, it's called pre-London. But
Why is it called pre-London?
Do you know why? I'll be honest.
I think I know why.
You probably do know why. A lot of people.
I don't.
I'll tell you why.
Go on.
I didn't go out to start a brand. I actually was obviously manufacturing denim jeans, and I needed a name for the jeans. I wasn't even that bothered about the jeans. The name. And it was only because the manufacturer said, you need a name. And I was like, I'm in Birmingham. No one cares about Birmingham. It's like I was saying, no one cares about Birmingham. Then I was thinking, I was living in Sheldon. I thought B26 postcode. And I was like, nah, don't be so daft. And then I was like, what should I do? Oh, I thought, I don't know what.
Should have called it Chestnuts.
Do you know what? And it was, all I thought was, all everyone cares about is London, Milan, you know, all the capitals,
Paris,
New York, Paris, blah, blah, blah. But we're not in London. Before London, Birmingham. Pre-London, before London, Birmingham.
So and I worked thought, it out, I was
pre-London. Mm. Pre-London, before London, Birmingham. Anyway, I was on the bus here going to work, by the way. I was getting the bus.
Where was you working then?
Oh, don't even start. That's another. I used to work in welfare to work. I used to help long-term unemployed people get back into work. I used to work in various different areas. I used to work in Chardin, helping long-term unemployed people. I ended up working for a company called Working Links in Birmingham City Centre. I then worked for them a number of years, but then actually from that, the contract ended and we ended up being transferred into Department of Work and Pensions. I was working for Department of Work. I was working for the Job Centre.
Isn't that ironic?
I know. Do you know what? I was dealing with sort of the training contracts for them, dealing with like South Birmingham College. Really enjoyed it, to be fair. I say enjoyed it, I didn't. I didn't. Do you know what? I got into there and I thought, I just got to get out of this place. Mm. So, that's where I worked. So I was getting the bus into the city centre to go to work.
And that's when the name comes
to
your
head.
Yeah,
that's where the name, sorry, diverted again. Yeah, that's where the name came about. Went on to GoDaddy. The main was free. Went on to intellectual property, the name was free, everything was free. So I was like, I'm doing it.
Yeah, written.
I thought, you know what? It was just sort of, it wasn't even, I didn't think of it any longer than probably an hour.
Sometimes the when name things was come done, to you and you know,
it was just
when
done.
You know, you know. It Can I go back so to mad. When you was talking about you as manufacturing jeans?
Yeah.
What do you mean by that?
Well, I'll tell you what happened.
So you didn't actually start out to become a clothing brand?
No, God, I never went to start a clothing brand.
I didn't know that.
No, I wouldn't have had a clue how to start a clothing brand. It wasn't about that then for me. I'll tell you what it was about. I was fed up with my job. I had a business advisor come in and said to me, me and her used to talk all the time, and she was like, I used to do a bit of DJing on the side. I used to do weddings.
Didn't know that.
Yeah. I used to... I was always doing a bit on the side kind of thing, and I was always doing like different bits, part-time work, you know, just trying to just increase my salary kind of thing. And she went, look, Ash, you don't have to reinvent the wheel. And I went, what are you on about? And she says, what are you interested in? I was interested in clothes, always interested in fashion. And I said to her, look, I bought these jeans. They're not brilliant. They're not great. And she went, well, go and make them the jeans. Jeans that you thought they were. And I said, what do you mean? She goes, well, you know, whatever you think those jeans are, why don't you just go and make them?
Mm.
And I went, I don't know where to start. She goes, you've got the internet. You've got, you know, you're sitting in front of the computer every day. So I did. That's what I did. I took a mission then to obviously make these jeans better than what I thought I was buying. So I went away. I started researching about manufacturing denim jeans. I started contacting factories.
In the UK or abroad?
No, abroad. I was researching where the best place to manufacture denim was Turkey. So I reached out to a couple of factories. I asked them to send me different fabric swatches, you know, just to get... I was trying to get, obviously, a designer premium feel fabric. But in my head, I thought, if I can bring a pair of jeans, that's going to retail at about £60, which is going to feel or look like a £200 pair of jeans, it's going to be successful. This is what I thought. There was no planning. There was no business plan. So I done what a lot of people did. I looked at designer jeans and the different fabrics. I reached out to a factory, and this one said, yeah, we'll send you some swatches and stuff. I managed to source a couple of good fabrics. I then measured a different few pairs of jeans, and I thought, well, I'm going to alter this where I think it needs to change and fit. I done all this by hand. And then I sent it to the factory, and they were like, yeah, £600, we'll make you some samples. I think it was some like four or six pairs of samples, £600. And I was like, it's a lot of money. But I had DJ money, so I was like, you know what, stuff it. I'm just going to pump that into that to see how it goes.
So at this point, are you thinking this could become a brand?
No.
Still no?
No. God, no. That's not, no, I was just making...
This is actually crazy that you never intending to do that.
No.
Most people that start a brand,
that's the problem.
Go with the intention
that
to start the brand.
That is the problem with a lot of people.
It's probably why I failed.
I think a lot of people think they can start a brand. Good luck. Go and start a brand and see how far you get, I tell you. No, all it was just to make some samples of these jeans. But obviously with the idea of that I was going to sell them and make a bit of money, I didn't have an idea of how much I was going to make. I will. In my head, I always thought about it. I wanted to get on the property ladder. I wanted to buy a property ladder. I wanted to buy a property, and I needed about 10 grand. And with working and paying, I was living in rented accommodation, and I was like, this isn't happening. I'm never getting on the property ladder. Never. Because I couldn't save. You know, going on holidays and all that, carry on. It's hard to save. So all I thought about, if I can make about 10 grand, that's my deposit here for a house. So that was my vision. I sampled these jeans. They came and they were completely crap. They were awful. They were terrible. I'll be honest with you, I cried. I sat there and I was like, this is a joke. I've just wasted 600 quid on this. I thought I knew. Measured it all. It was all wrong. Everything felt wrong about it. And all I thought is, I've been done over here. You're a twash. You've just been done over. Like,
they probably just sent you four pairs of jeans. I'd sat there.
So anyway, I messaged the guy at the factory, and I was like, look, mate, it's all wrong. And he went, no, it's not. I went, it is. And he went, it's not. It went on. Me and him, I was walking in off the bus to work, and I was WhatsApping him every day going, mate, it's wrong. And one day, about 2-3 months later, he texts me saying, the technician's checked and we've got it all wrong. And he goes, we're going to remake them for you. And I went, what? He said, yeah, we'll remake them for you. And I went, oh, sound. They came through, and they're exactly what I expected. And
so
I knew,
there you go, that's written.
Oh, I just knew when they arrived, I went, if I can get these to market, I've smashed it. I'm going to make some dough here. I worked opposite a guy, and he said to me, do you know what, Ash? If it fails, you'll be on Wellsbourne Market. And I went, what? He said, just sell them on Wellsbourne Market, mate. And I went, you got a point. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. biggest wrong. Like.
You still make a tenner on top.
Yeah. I think they were costing me, believe it or not, I think it was about £13.50
wow.
per pair of jeans. But that wasn't even half of it. So they came, they arrived, and I was buzzing, contacting him. He was like, yeah, for these jeans, it's going to cost you 15 grand. I think it was two colours, four styles, something like that. And I was like, what? And he went, yeah, mate, 15 grand. Can you send the deposit, 50%? And I was like, no. He went, why? I went, mate, I got 50 quid. I swear to God, I didn't have a penny. And he was like, what did you think they were going to cost? And I said, I don't know. I said, maybe a couple of grand. And he went, mate, we've got to set machines up here. This isn't a small job. We don't set me. I think it's something like 600 pairs per colour per style. And I was like, mate, I can't. And he was like, you haven't got it. And he went, could you do half? And I went, I don't know, I have to come back to you. And he went, oh, you don't sound like you're serious, which I didn't have no money. I was sort of just going through. I don't know what. I think I was just trying to escape from the day-to-day of my job, having this dream. I think that's what it was at the time, because I was so fed up with my job and because I just never had any money. I was always broke, you know what I mean? It was just one of them. So I came away from it and he was like, look, mate, if you can't afford it, you need to walk away. So, and I was just, then I was messaging him trying to go, will you do half? And he went, but you said you haven't got, I said, but would you do half? And he went, no. And I went, come on, mate. Anyway, went on then. Because from having the jeans samples to actually coming through the production, it must have been at least 6 months. It went on that long. I'll tell you how long it went on. Because on this process, I've sort of probably jumped ahead here. He actually asked me for a name. That's when I had to come up for the sample of jeans pre-London. We got the samples. And I had already shot them then on a lad called Brad Skelly. And it went on after me shooting with him. I launched the photos on Instagram and everyone was asking when these jeans were coming. They were never coming because I could never afford them. So it went on for about 6 months of me going back and forth every day, WhatsApping this guy. And then in January, because I remember it, because it was dead at the factory, he turned around and says, tell you what, 7.5 grand, we'll do the production for you, half the amount. I went and still did. I didn't have 7.5 grand. And she, like the missus said to me going, what are you doing? Where are you going to get this? I went, I don't know, but I know I've got something here. I've got something. So I went and seen my nan on the evening and I said to her, going, Nan, I'm fed up here. I've really had enough of life. I said, I've got this idea. I know I can make a bit of dough, but I need 7.5 grand. I'll be honest, I was hoping she was going to bail me out. She was, it weren't happening. And she went, have you got any credit cards? I went, yeah. And she goes, well, what have you got? I said, I got, it was a Virgin. And I've mentioned this before. I had a Virgin credit card. And you could have had 0% transfer for 2 years. And she went, just do it. And if you believe in it, do it. You're so unhappy. Just do it. Have a go. You know, she said to me, I came to this country, Ash. Look at all the things I've done. Like she always set up businesses. She bought her own house. She done really well when she came to this country. She went, have a go. So I wired the money to him the next day. I got the money off my credit card into my bank and then wired the money to him, 7.5 grand. It was in the January. And then I went to bed. And I started panicking because I do panic a bit. And I was like, I've just wired 7.5 grand to a man in Turkey. I don't even know. Never met.
That's what I was going to say. Yeah. Was you not worried that this money was just going to go missing?
Oh, yeah. Oh, I thought it was definitely going missing. I thought it's a goner. I thought this is gone. I've been done over. And I was messaging him. He was like, look, I told you. Because we launched in the April. And he went, it'll take 3 months. You know, was it 3 months? Yeah, we've probably production time, 6 weeks production time, then obviously travelling via road. And he kept saying, it's going to take you, you know, about 3 months here, mate. So, yeah, I panicked every day. Every day I thought, I'm a twat. I've just wired 7.5 grand. Never going to see it again. But not a long story, they arrived and I had to jump through so many hoops. I learned all on the job then because then I had to learn about how to import goods. Mm-hmm. And suddenly I had to find out I needed a Uri number to import goods. I was like, the factory was saying to me, you never imported goods before. I went, no, I've never done any of this before.
You need somewhere to import them to.
Yeah. We had to get, obviously then I had to get clearance, you know, via customs and stuff like that. So I learned on the job very quickly. And it was just, it was suddenly a problem came up and it was just like, right, how do we solve it? How do I get around it? To the point then where, like, the shipment was going to be delivered. I was still working at the time then. I was doing full-time work. And I said to her, Mrs., the jeans are arriving today. And she was like, okay, no problem. I says, well, you know, any problems, give me a call. I was at work. Next thing you know, I got this lorry, this truck driver on the phone. He went, mate, I've got 3 pallets here to be delivered. This is a residential address. I went, yeah, my missus is in. He went, mate, it's like a two-bed little terraced house, isn't it? I went, yeah, that's mine. He says, you haven't even got a drive, have you? I went, no, it's just a little terraced house. He went, mate, there's 3 pallets. He went, this ain't going to get in your house. I went, it will. And then the missus phoned me and she was like, Ash, there's fucking pallets of jeans arrived at the house. That's where it went. And literally, I had to say to work, going, I feel sick, I've got to go home. I had to go home because I was panicking.
And you was excited?
I was excited. I was on the bus, still on the bus. Yeah. You know what I mean? Got off the bus, fucking running down the road, and all I seen was 3 pallets in outside our house, in the road, this is. And I'm there going, get him in the fucking house. Someone's going to rob him. They're going to rob him. And literally, our living room was only as small as your... It was about the size of your studio. Then we just had a kitchen off the living room. It was only a small little house. And I built all round the bay window boxes of jeans, all round the bay window. I had boxes of jeans, like a fucking dining table in front of me, in front of the TV. The toilet was filled up with jeans. No, it's no word of a lie. The downstairs toilet, I went, just fill it. Feel it. I literally filled the whole... Where you turn...
How'd you go for a piss?
We had to go upstairs. We had a toilet downstairs. You know where we had a bathroom and toilet upstairs? Yeah, I just said, fill it. The back door, everything was full with these jeans. And I was... Oh, it was pure madness. And she was like going, what are you fucking doing? What are you doing? And I said, I didn't realise. Because I hadn't a clue.
But you've ordered 1,200 pairs of jeans,
but
you?
I didn't know what that looked like. Do you know what I mean? It's hard to... Well, and I'll tell you what, Curtis, so I've done production. We've done productions for obviously retailers and stuff, and they've ordered so many. When you see it on pallets, you're like, fuck, this is a lot of gear. But yeah, it was 3 pallets. And from that, I was like, don't worry, we'll sell them. Do you know what I mean? So...
Straight into your Dowboy era then?
Yeah. Oh, God, it was proper Dowboy job. And, like, going back, yeah, I used to sell my nan and grandma's fruit and veg to the neighbours, so I was always a bit of a Dowboy. When I was about 10, I was always round the run of beans down the Hobmore Road in Small Leaf because the allotment's across the road, and I used to sell all these fruit and veg. So, yeah, it was just like, that's it. It was always a bit of just buying and selling. That's how I seen the jeans. It's just a bit of a buying and selling.
Yeah, you're just buying for low and selling for high.
Yeah, that's it. And I think it's a good business model as well.
Even though it's not that simple.
No, it isn't that simple. No, it's not. But I suppose that's how I made it as being that. And I think at the time, obviously going back now, Instagram was really new. So before these jeans arrived, I'd shot them and we'd launched them on Instagram. I was posting the pictures of them. And everyone was, it was obviously before the algorithm, and everyone, when you posted, everyone's seen it. And everyone was like, when are these jeans coming? So I'd sort of built up the hype already.
You was prime social media influencer marketing, wasn't you?
Yeah.
Like, just get the model in the jeans,
yeah.
Post it on social media, and it will start to circulate.
Yeah. It was the great time then. I think it was sort of the heyday, and I think, social media marketing and like Instagram, it was brilliant, and I think they've ruined it now. But yeah, so we sort of had that sort of customer base sitting there waiting. Like I went from doing that to designing the website through Shopify. Never done that before. I did everything myself, by the way. This wasn't like there was no one else involved in it. So I built the Shopify website. I said, right, we'll launch. I think it was the 26th of April, I remember right, online. I think, right, we'll launch it now. I hit the button. No clue about websites or anything. I said, we'll hit the button. And I says, well, we went down just to the pub by us, and I went, right, we'll go down there, have a bit of food, just to relax, see what happens. Went down there, I ordered my curry and a beer, like, got it all on order, hit the button, and nothing was happening. No orders were coming through, nothing, I swear to God. And then people were DMing the page on Instagram, can't check out. Because I never applied a payment method. So literally...
Sending the money to
my
nowhere.
My chicken booner was on the way to my table. I had to leave the pub, go straight to the house and put a payment method on. So, yeah, I was like... So that was a massive, never forget that day. So literally, I was like, I've just ordered my food here. And I went, I've got to get home. I hadn't attached a payment method. So, like, even setting up a website, I was so naive and, like, didn't even research. It didn't go on YouTube or anything. I just sort of went through what, sort of fumbled my way through it, launched it. And I think we sold about 26 pairs that night. So even though it was such a bit of a farce of a launch, we still sold 26 pairs, which I was like, this is brilliant. This
is. Most people don't sell in the first day like that.
No.
Not as a new brand.
No. I think, though, there was this 6 months of it's coming. The countdown was never ending to the point where people...
the suspense.
Yeah, people were like, is this ever coming? And
like,
I don't think...
Like that fire film, throwing a false festival.
So, but I don't think it was as flooded as much back then as what it is now. So, yeah, we sold and, yeah, it went nice and steady. And to be fair, the boxes were disappearing out of my living room. And then I went into just a small storage unit then. Finally then went, right, I'll get a storage unit. So I moved into a storage unit, only like a shed type size. And the wife was picking and packing the jeans and sending them out. And off the back of that... the guy who modelled for me said, you should put that name on a T-shirt. And I went, I don't know. And he went, yeah, I think it's really good. And I went, do you think? He went, yeah, well, you know, you need to shoot the jeans with something else. So obviously then we slapped the logo on the T-shirt, on just a black T-shirt and a white T-shirt. And then people were asking when they were coming. And I think I went back to Turkey for manufacturing of T-shirts. I found a factory. And I ordered about 200 black T-shirts. Or was it? No, was it, I think it was 300. I think the minimum was quite high then. And it was like 300 black, 300 white. And then launched them and they started taking off. People were buying the jeans and the T-shirt. I didn't even think about get restocking here. I was just thinking about turning this stock into money.
And paying your loan off.
Well, that was another thing. I thought, I've got my 7.5K loan. I've got 2 years. Get that paid off. And I thought, well, do you know, you're going to make a bit of a good, decent profit here. But I just sort of snowballed then into the T-shirts, launched the T-shirts. But then summer was coming because it was April, launched the jeans. The T-shirts came in about May, back end of May, and then it was getting warm.
Mm.
And everyone was like, have you got any vests? I was like, vests? They went, yeah. I was like, I ain't got no money for vests because I reinvested some of the stock. This is what I had no money for vests. So, because I reinvested some of the jeans stock into T-shirts. And then the guy who modeled for me said to me, just cut the T-shirt. I cut the arms off the T-shirt, sent it to Brad. He took a picture in this sleeveless T-shirt that I just cut out with scissors. And everyone was like, posted the picture on Instagram and was like, when's the vest dropping? So literally, this is...
I wasn't expecting this.
No, so I was still working full-time there. What I did, I'd made a paper template, an A4 paper, and from this paper template, for a different size, we used to pin it to the T-shirts, and me and the guy that I used to work with in the office, we used to, every day, cut in the T-shirts. So all the vests were made to order. I'd get in the morning and start cutting these T-shirts for the vest orders. So yeah, it was so... So I went from jeans, T-shirts, to then making my own vests. to then, I suppose, the biggest thing that happened after then, we had Foot Asylum reach out to us.
They reached out just after this?
Yeah, it was midsummer. Literally, I'd launched in the April. They reached out to me midsummer, DM'd me on Instagram, and a lad called Danny. And he just said, love the brand, love what I see, you know, can we meet up? And I was still working full-time, and I was said to my mate, I went, I can't meet them. I says, I ain't got a clue what I'm doing. I'm sitting here cutting T-shirts. I'm sitting here, like, winging it. And he was like, Ash, look at your product that you've built now. Look at the jeans. Look at the T-shirts, the vests. You know, you are building something here. And actually, that's when I sort of realised then it was sort of a brand that I was building, even though it sort of just snowballed into these things, like, you know, a T-shirt, then a vest, that kind of thing. And he went, just meet him, what have you got to lose? Anyway, I messaged him back. I said, look, mate, I can meet you. And he went, what's best, Manchester or Birmingham? And I was working. I was like, Birmingham, mate. I thought you're going to have to meet me at lunchtime.
Yeah.
So I'd come out of work. So I arranged the meeting. I literally got out my shirt and trousers, got in my own pre-London gear, took my little bag with me and met him at Cafe Nero. Got out my jeans on the table, got my T-shirts out and sat there. He was having a cheat. He was a decent, good lad, to be fair. And he turned around, he wasn't really giving me any sort of inkling whether he liked it or not. And then he just turned around and he said, "These are the best jeans we've ever seen, mate." He said, "We've already bought them. We've already had them in our office." He said, "These are unbelievable. We love the product. Your T-shirt quality is fantastic." Because I always went for like quality of the feel and stuff like that. And he went, "And we just love the name." And I went, "Do you?" And he went, "Yeah." Oh, do you know what? Because I wasn't even bought into the name that much. I liked it because I put a fadder above the pre, the E. Because, mm-hmm. I mean, I'm being Irish. So that's where that comes from when people say, "Why have you got that?" I went, it was just sort of a nod to my nan. But I wasn't that bought into the name. And he went, "Oh, we love it. We just think the name's brilliant. We think the product's brilliant. We want to buy it." And I was like, "Okay." And he went, "We want to place an order." And I was like, "All right, well," he says, "when I get back to the office, I'll send you an order." So he did. I think it was £30,000, the first order he sent me. And I was sitting there thinking, "Oh, fuck. What, how am I going to do this?" And to be fair, like, Noel, he was my mate, like, he won't mind me saying, mature chap, 60s. He was like, "Ash, just work it out." I went, "I can't run a third." I think I worked it out to be something like, it was going to cost me 15 grand. It was nearly 50%, probably a bit less, the production. So he went, "Get a loan, do this, do that." And I went, "I don't think, I couldn't be bothered." I thought, "I don't really want to get, I've already got 7.5K credit card." So anyway, I just contacted the factories and says, "Look, mate, I've got this order for jeans. This is how much it is. I can't, you know, I've got no money. I've stretched myself to do this first production." I was still with my first production selling this off then. And he went, "Have you got a purchase order?" I went, "Yeah." He said, "Send it me over." I did. And he went, "We'll make them. When you get paid, you pay us." And I went, "What?" And he says, "Yeah." And I was like, "Okay."
That's not so easy.
Yeah. That's what happened. That, I swear to God, that's what, I know. So.
Wow. So he must have believed in your brand at that point, well, then. And obviously you saw a name like Foot Asylum come across the desk,
yeah, well,
and they're going to be familiar with that.
Well, that's it. I think that's what happened. And so with the people who were manufacturing the T-shirts for me, they were exactly the same. They were like, "Don't worry." They gave me credit, which I was shocked. I was like, but I did know, because it's import duty, you have to pay on goods. So when I was still doing my online sales, I was saving my money. I'll be honest, if you had anything I was making at the start, I didn't spend. I never spent a penny for the first year of that business. Never. There was nothing spent.
Can I ask what it turned over in the first year?
Well, I started in the April. They come on. The first financial year, it was about, I think it was 400. But that, it was like a part year. But then into half, it was about 400 grand. Well, actually, it was more because I was, you know, no, I'll be honest with you. I started off as, you know, I didn't obviously be a limited company because I didn't know what I was doing. I was sort of a sole trader at the start. So I didn't go limited till the September. So it went from our then September to the following September. I think it was 800 grand.
Wow.
It was, yeah, just shy of £1 million. That was in the first. And I'll be straight with you now, within April till the end of December, I'd cleared 100 grand clear. Like, that, obviously, that was like profit.
That's amazing.
I know. And I was buzzing because I was like.
And you just wanted to make a pair of jeans?
I just wanted to, and I was like, I'm on the way here to be able to buy a house. Like,
yeah.
Because of how it was going, it wasn't that, because it got to the point then with Foot Asylum's orders, because obviously we started off with the 30 grand one, but then it jumped to like 60, 90, 150. It just kept jumping. And I needed the cash there to finance the deposits then, because when it did start jumping, they wanted deposits because they were like...
Yeah, of course, it's big numbers, so, isn't it?
The money that I was pulling in, it was good that I was still working because I just could use it to run the business. And that's what I did. And then, yeah, I think by the end of December, yeah, I had 100 grand because I said to the guy I worked with, and I still hated my job, by the way. I was still sitting there doing the day-to-day job. And I was still DJing? I think I was still, because I still had commitments for DJing. And I said to my mate, going, he said, "How much you got in the bank?" I said, 100 grand. He said, "What? I said, yeah, I got 100 grand in the bank.
And he went, fuck are you doing here?
He says, what are you doing here? And I went, I don't know. And he went, Ash, you've got to take this serious now. You've got an opportunity. So literally, I went downstairs, said to the manager, I'm gone. And she went, what? I went, I'm gone. There's my notice. And I walked out that same day. It was actually on the 2nd of January. I went away.
What year were you in here?
I left the job in 2018. Yeah. Because I started the brand. I launched it in 17, left 2nd Jan 2018, yeah. Literally walked in after Christmas holidays and I was like, what am I doing? Just walked in. They all knew anyway, everyone had grassed me up, saying he's got a branding foot, that's all of me has. You know, they all, it sort of got, you know, even people that I was working with were talking and they were all like going, he's got a clothing brand that's in foot, so on that guy upstairs.
And yeah. Obviously at that point, I think you're a fucking millionaire, don't know.
Well, I don't know what they thought, I don't, you know. So, and I was like, but Foot Asylum, they knew I was still working as well. Because they were like, I can't believe you still work. I used to go out on the stairs and take calls from the factories and everyone. I was taking calls while it was all going on because I didn't know how far this was going. I did not have a clue how far this was going to run, whether it was going to suddenly, you know, end next month or in 6 months.
You're probably scared to take the jump as well. You've got a little bit of security there. Massive. You're messing with big numbers. And if you leave that, then it's completely reliant on the brand then, isn't it?
Well, this is what I mean. Like, I had a secure job, you know, as everyone, good pension, all that rubbish. I was 37 and I was like, what's the 37, 38? And I was like going, you know, you've got to calculate, haven't you? Can you, can't you? And when you've never had money or you've never, you know, experience it, you sort of are careful and you sort of fray away from. A lot of people aren't risk, they're all risk averse, aren't they? People won't take risks, especially when they get into big numbers like me now, when they're sitting at my age. People are risk averse. Younger people will take more risks, but when you get to 37, a lot of people won't. Like, I had mates saying to me, can't believe you've done 7.5 grand on a credit card on just like a little dream. Mm. He went, I wouldn't risk 200 quid on something. Mm.
But that's why they're always going to stay in the same place.
This is it. I think you have to take risks. Nothing venture, nothing gain. And you know what? And this is the thing. If you're not happy and you're sitting in that job 9 to 5 and you're not doing anything to change it, then how do you expect things to change? It doesn't land on your lap, does it?
No, you've got to take a risk at some point.
Yeah.
Otherwise, you're just going to be doing the same thing forever.
I know.
And that would scare the life out of me, personally.
Oh, I know. Well, this is it.
There's nothing wrong with it.
No.
But for me personally, that would scare the life out of me.
I think I'm the same. I think I've changed. I've changed, like, so many different, like, careers, jobs after, like, so many different years, I think. And I think I'll always be the same. I don't think I will stop at one industry. I'll move on to something else. I think I need that sort of buzz and excitement and that sort of, like, learning aspect of the industry. Mm. Learning.
Keeps the flame alive, though.
Yeah. And, like, when people say you can't do this, you can't do that, but you can. You don't need to go to university, you know, to do some of the different things that they say you need to. But yeah.
So you're in Foot Asylum now. The orders are doubling. Irish. Doubling. Yeah. You're in Foot Asylum. The orders are doubling. I'm guessing we're in 2018, 2019 now.
Yeah.
What's the next step from there?
Well, we first started off, I think they tested us in, I don't know, about 20 stores. It went well. This is how the orders doubled.
All in the UK?
Yeah. They only have stores in the UK, Foot Asylum. They sort of this is where the orders doubled. They sort of test you in 20 stores. Then they move you into, like, 30 stores. We went to, like, 40. Then to, I think they've got, like, 65 stores. So then we just sort of went to then being in full 65 stores, so then being sort of the main brand within the 65 stores alongside Nietzsche. That was 2018, 2019. Yeah, I remember
going into Foot Asylum them times and half the shop was pre-London.
Oh, I know. Do you know what?
Half the shop was pre-London.
Yeah. I used to get so many people send me pictures, you know, especially family members. Well, on my wife's side as well, they used to send me pictures of this. Yeah, do you know what? It was unsurreal, really. It didn't feel real. Mm. Do you know what I mean? It was always, the whole journey hasn't felt real, really. It feels like it's been a long time, but it feels like it's gone quick as well. But yeah, it was mad. It was mad going in there and seeing it all. And, you know, it was a bit mental because it felt like it happened really quickly as well. So, but Yeah, and just seeing people walking about in it. And I remember, like, I used to go out and have a drink. I'd see someone in it going, oh, I own that brand. They'd be like, what are you on about, mate? You know, looking at me going, are you for real? And then I got to the point where going, I'm not going to say to anyone that I own that brand. I'm not even going to mention it to anyone anymore. So, yeah, it was mad, but it was so busy. Like, I was so busy because when you obviously launch a collection within a retailer, which I had to learn on the job, really, on how sort of the fashion industry and retail works, which, because I'd never worked in it before, I didn't have a clue. So then I had to work on their timescales and how they plan, because they plan so far ahead. And I think that was one of the things I did struggle with, because they were looking, when they'd already bought sort of a collection for spring or summer, or say if they were buying a collection for spring, they already wanted to see summer. Then they already wanted to see autumn, because they sort of work so far ahead. So I was busy working away then, going, how can I move this on? How can I change this? It was just constant. It was to the point at the start where I didn't even have a designer. It was sort of where me and my son, who he was at school at the time, was helping me sort of CAD colours up and move things around. And it was so basic that we were doing at the start. At the start, it got to the point where it was just a name on a T-shirt and you colour it up. But then things changed, you know, stripes come in, you know, patterns come in. We launched striped T-shirts. I don't even remember striped T-shirts.
Yeah.
We were the biggest brand for striped T-shirts at the time. We absolutely smashed it. You know, if that never went away, I could have probably retired a long time ago. Striped T-shirts never ended. But, yeah, we were probably the biggest
brand.
They
didn't stay for long, did they? The striped T-shirts.
They were about a year. I think they were a year in. And then I think the following year, we tried to do a cut and sew where half of the T-shirt was striped. But, yeah, they come and go. But so does fashion, really. Things change. But, yeah, we smashed then. So then it's looking at what's the next thing? And then, like, Foot Asylum did assist me with many different things. They helped and supported me with some of the design side of it, because they knew. There was like, this guy's a one-man band here. You know, I was like, guys, I'm on this treadmill. It's running, you know, it's going that fast. I can't keep up. So I was trying to recruit people then to come and sort of work for me while they were supporting me. So, yeah, we just grew massively to the point where I was outgrowing sort of the storage place that I was in with stock and stuff like that. Still trying to concentrate on the online, still running the social media, doing no email marketing at that point. We didn't do any Facebook ads, any Google ads, anything like that for probably 4 years of the brand. We didn't need to touch it.
Wow. So that's just literally carrying it itself then?
Everything was organic.
Yeah. People just really loved it.
No, but I missed out on loads. I missed out on millions of pounds.
But maybe you was meant to, because you was already running too fast. Do you know what I mean?
Do you know what? I know. I think
you might have messed it all up if that got to a place that you couldn't handle.
I don't think
we'd
have kept up. Yeah.
Yeah.
I think we only brought in, I think it was a fair few years in before we brought in a guy to do ads. And then I was suddenly going, oh my God, what, these ads? This is meant.
Doing well.
Yeah.
At what point do you start employing staff there?
Oh,
because obviously you've got to the point where you must have a warehouse.
Yeah, I left in the January work, went full time. We had a storage unit. I'll be honest with you, Foot Asylum knew I didn't have a warehouse, so they accommodated me. They were great. Do you know what? The guy who owned it is now, he's sold it now, David Makin. A lot of the staff there were fantastic with me. What he let me do was I could send the stock in direct from the factory. So it never hit us. It came into the UK and it went straight to their warehouse. So I didn't have to facilitate that. And that was one thing that they helped me with. Because
that's a huge cost save as well.
Well, it did. At the start, I was doing it and I was like, I couldn't get the storage. They were arriving at my storage centre and it was like, this is ridiculous, the amounts, and even the storage centre was putting into loads of different units. But then I'd have to pull it out the next day to then ship it on to Manchester. So I spoke to them and they helped me on that side of it. And if it weren't for them, I wouldn't have got to where I got to, because they did support me along the way, which, you know, you just can't put the infrastructure in so quick. But then from doing that, then I had to grow my own. So When did I start recruiting? My wife came on board full time. I had my two brothers work for me. And I had my uncle at one point in the warehouse. We had, I say it was a warehouse. It was a storage unit, which we knocked every wall down. We nearly took the whole place over. It was only low level. And then I got racking in. But then we even outgrew that to the point where we were in other storage units and we couldn't even find boxes some days. We just grew that quick to the point where it was just, yeah, it was probably, we probably grew too quick. We then brought an agent on because we were online in Foot Asylum. We brought an agent on who then brought us into probably another 100 stores we were in on top of Foot Asylum.
And you're still doing your own sales online?
Still doing our own sales. Well, yeah, we were in a... Saying that, it was probably more, actually, because we had 80 stores that were in Ireland alone. We were the biggest brand in Ireland.
Wow.
Oh, yeah.
80 stores in Ireland alone?
Well, we're in DV8, who have 50 stores, and we're probably in at least 30 independents on top of that. And then we're probably in 30, 40 independents in the UK, and then probably 200 stores at one point. We never went further than the UK and Ireland, which I just couldn't handle, to be fair. Just got too much.
It's got to take its toll on you. You're in 200 stores. You're running this basically with your missus.
Yeah.
And you've still got your own sales going on.
Yeah.
You've employed family members, so that's a big weight in itself. Yeah.
We had a couple of freelance people. We had a marketing guy, we had a designer, and we had obviously an agent who was handling some of the retail side of it. But yeah, oh, do you know what? I was working day and night. I was probably working up till 10 o'clock most days, probably from 6 in the morning, WhatsApp, telephone calls, emails. It was all the admin side of it, which... Because I wasn't great at school, the admin side of it I did struggle on, you know, and the constant emails. When you start running a business, and especially dealing with retailers, you get so many different departments email you and you're just bombarded. So, yeah, I was literally flat out and I was dealing with probably 80% of sort of the workload. I was the person that was doing it and I was heading up everything, the design man. I was the person... That was speaking to the manufacturers, dealing with any of the sampling, dealing with sort of, you know, anything to do with the design. It was all me. And then obviously I was running all the import side of it, bringing the goods in. I was even chipping in on picking and packing, offloading wagons, you know, you name it, I was doing it. And then obviously planning photo shoots, liaising between models, dealing with Instagram. I think... I only stopped dealing with the Instagram page a couple of years ago. I handed it to my brother. I was like, I'm just done with, you know, it just got far too much, if I'm honest with you. It went from being this something, you know, where it just consumed my life. It took over. I was just drowning at one point.
Have you ever had it value to sell?
I looked at selling probably 2 years ago. And it's one of those. It was probably valued. They turn around and say, obviously, it goes off your turnover. I don't know if it's 2.5 or whatever it might be, but we were probably averaging probably 4 or 5 million a year.
Wow,
the last few years. So I probably should have sold it a few years ago, if I'm honest with you. Yeah.
But well, you're looking at 10 to 15 million then?
Yeah, I should have. Do you know what? When we were at our height, I probably should have gone. But I was enjoying it.
It was your baby, weren't it?
No, it was.
Well, yeah, it was your baby.
It was my baby. It was sort of what sort of represented me as well. It sort of gave me that sort of, you know.
Purpose.
Yeah, well, yeah. And people knew me as Mr. Pre, and it was like, oh, that's the guy who owns the brand. Do you know what I mean? Suddenly then. I went from knowing no one to like knowing everyone. Like, I used to go out and it'd be like everyone. It was just madness. I couldn't get over the madness. That's on the other flip side of it all, just of what sort of exposure, which I probably never built on my personal side of the branding, because I've never been outspoken about what I've done. I've never sat here going, I've done this, I've done that. Do you know what I've done? And this is where a lot of things have changed now. A lot of brand owners sit there and talk about, you know, what they've done, and where I sort of hid behind it. You'd never really see me. And this is probably one of the first, well, this is the first time that I've talked about probably the journey from the start and probably to now. I've not talked about anything.
When I reached out to you, I didn't expect you to say yes, because you've always seemed like quite a reserved guy. Your personal social media following isn't high.
No.
Not many people know the person behind the brand.
No.
And I didn't really expect you to say yes to this.
Yeah.
And that's why when we spoke, I was like, well, how in-depth do you want to go? Because yeah. I didn't know how far you'd want to go. But it's good now because
yeah,
the whole point of this really is to explain and inspire.
Yeah.
Because a lot of people like me would love to know how you came from that kid with no GCSEs to building a brand that's worth potentially 15 million, 20 million. And I think it is important that people like you do sit down eventually and tell your story, because there's so many people that would be inspired by it.
No, thanks. No, I know. And do you know what? I think it's an age thing as well. Why I didn't want to do it. And I think I don't know, you just leave yourself open, especially on social media now, where a lot of people they haven't got anything nice to say, they'll always like say something more negative. And if I'm honest with you, I kept my personal Instagram locked down for a long, long time, because it was just being opened up to so many different people that I didn't really know. And I was like, and when you've got kids and stuff, I thought, do I really want everyone, you know, knowing what I'm up to and stuff like that? And I think social media has changed for brand owners and stuff now, where a lot of them use it as sort of more of a business platform, where I was sort of exposing everything. Like in lockdown, I was going live. I was having some of the best times in lockdown.
I was going live in my hot tub in your garden.
And I was opening up. But I was opening up to anyone, everyone, and I was telling it straight how it is. Anyone asked me a question about the industry or whatever it might be, I'd tell them straight, where there's too many people that, I suppose, maybe in a good way, a very professional in a way they're delivering their content on the social media, where I just say, oh, it is. And my missus didn't like that. She was sort of going, I think you should rein that in, or you need to sort of separate sort of your business to your home life. So instead of doing any of that and just not having time, I just went, right, I'm shutting my personal Instagram down. And actually, when you've bought something that you're proud of doing or achieving, you get hit down all the time on social media. Like,
just jealousy, man.
Yeah. My son bought a pair of Gucci shoes and I was so proud he got them. And I just got attacked on my inbox saying, do you think that's the right way of how you're, you know, leading your children? And I thought, you don't even know me. You don't even know my upbringing, my background, you know. People have always got an opinion on stuff, so... yeah, that's why I was very quiet. But I'm happy to speak about it because I'm an outgoing kind of guy. But... like running any business, it hasn't been easy. Like, I've had the ups and downs. I've had battles. I've had legal battles, which a lot of brand owners have, and they don't want to. And, you know, half the time we can't talk about it and we don't want to talk about it. So we sometimes just switch ourselves off. It isn't easy. Running any business isn't easy. And if it's successful, you'll always become a target. It doesn't matter what the person is, you know, whether it's from an employee, from you know, from another business, from another brand, you can be, you know, you're just a target, and it's a shame, really. So, yeah, so that's where I just think, you know what, sometimes that's why I've just stayed quiet, really. I just think, you know what, yeah, I've just sort of stepped away from it and think, do I want to talk about it? Don't I? So, yeah.
I remember all your live videos in your hot tub in your back garden.
Oh, yeah.
You got the nice AstroTurf down and the goals for the kids. Oh, God, I remember.
I was doing that all the time.
Yeah. There's a few beers in the hot tub on live. Yeah,
I know.
So obviously when you're running this huge brand and you've got family members employed, you've got warehouses, you're in 200 plus stores across the whole of the UK. How heavy is that? On the mental.
Do you know what? I think you end up forgetting about yourself. backtracking a bit, I used to go to the gym every day before I started the brand. And that sort of it inspired me as well, because I was like, I think I was really mentally strong back then. But when you're dealing with, because you don't realise it until you're in it, and then you're sitting there going, I've got so many emails to answer, so many WhatsApps, so many meetings, so many conversations with people I need to have. I've only got so many days. So many hours in a day. I've also got, obviously, I've got kids as well, and you just lose track on yourself. You lose track on even your relationship, like with my missus and my kids, and that all gets put to the side. You have to sort of like, you forget yourself and you forget them, because you're just this sort of like, I don't know, like this object that's running this business, this brand now.
It's like a motor.
Yeah. And you get so many people, like, I understand now, managers, you get so many people coming to you with different issues and problems, and you're the person that's got to sort it on top of doing everything else. So yeah, it has a massive impact. And I think, looking back, it does drain you, but you can't, you're like a hamster, you can't get off that wheel. You step off that wheel, you've missed a season, you're dropped. You'd be dropped by, if you can't supply Foot Asylum for spring or autumn, you don't have a range ready, and not just talking about designing it, you've got to sample everything, you've got to make sure the colours are all right, you've got to work with all the factories. That has a massive impact on you, to the point where, I used to wake up tired. And then I was trying to be out as well, promoting the brand, and that involves alcohol, that involves late nights, to the point where, you do get burnt out. And I think you don't realise it until it's too late sometimes. I think it is hard, and I've been affected by it, definitely. I've been definitely affected by it. But people just say, what are you moaning for? Look at people, money, whatever it might be you've got. But that's not the be all and end all. Do you know what I mean? Mm. So yeah, it's hard. It can be hard. And no one can understand it either. And then you speak to friends and they'll, they don't sympathise with you. They're like, what are you moaning for?
You've got everything. Yeah.
You've been in America. You was in LA on a photo shoot. You're in Ibiza. You're doing this. You're driving a Porsche. You're doing all that. And like, you're there going, yeah, but I feel shit. Mm. I feel really shit.
What's the future of Pre-London? Where do you go from here? That's a really nice hoodie, by the way.
No, cheers.
Just for anyone watching.
I decided to take a break. The brand's not gone. The brand's still sitting there. But for myself, I decided it was after 7 years, it was right to take time out. We still had demand for the brand. We still had retailers looking for the brand. We still get people contacting us now on social media. But for myself, I thought, I sort of lost interest. We sort of went through a path where... we were obviously heavily involved in wholesaling and designing for retailers, and we went down a path. And the style of clothing that we were doing, I just fell out of love with it. It wasn't really what I would wear, and I just was like going, I was doing it just for the sake of making money, where I got to the point where going, do you know what? I don't want to do this. I don't want to do pre anymore. I want to stop. At the moment, I'm helping with a couple of the brands, moving them forward, and obviously going through my, helping with the experience that I've got and overcoming some of the issues that they've got and making sure they don't fall down the different pitfalls that I've gone through. It probably will be back at some point. I don't know when. I've got one of the biggest retailers watching me. I've got one, and they're asking me. I'm like, I just want this year out. I just want time out this year for myself, for my family. I'm happy enough now. I'm just potting around, sorting out stuff in my garden, stuff like that, and just thinking about myself.
Being an old man.
Yeah, just thinking about myself, breaking away from all the WhatsApps, everything. So I would like to say I'll be back. I've had people ask me to bring it to other countries, but I want to make sure when I do that I'm ready to do it.
Yeah, so, you've got to make sure that your own mental's right first and everything's right.
And there's other different styles of clothing that I want to do as well. But at this moment in time, yeah, I'm happy just
being
chilling
content.
Out, yeah, and looking forward to going on another holiday.
Where are you off to?
I'm probably going to go back to the Mardin Palace in the Titanic Mardin Palace in Turkey, which is an all-inclusive, amazing place in the summer. Last year I was in Dubai. Last year I was in Florida at Disney World. So, but even then, I couldn't enjoy the holidays. I just want to go on this holiday and not have the phone buzzing.
Never stops, does it?
Never stops. I used to be around the port on the phone. I used to be in the room, have to get my laptop open. I've got to send a purchase order to a factory. Customer service, my wife was doing that. She'd have to jump on the customer service, couldn't be by the pool. So just to be able to walk away from that just for a period of time is nice. So
there's still going to be people watching this thinking, what are you complaining about?
Oh, I know. But, do you know
like,
what?
Sitting on your laptop on holiday, but you don't understand. Like, when you can't switch off, it's so, so heavy.
But it's not even that. There would be, like, samples arriving at our office, and they'd be like, you're not back for another week. You know, we need the approval. It's just fucking, it was just constant. Yeah, can't moan. But I think it goes down to, like, 7 years. I never had a day off. Not working 9 till 5. It's like working 6 in the morning. Obviously, I started dealing with China. It starts at 6 in the morning. We go until 10 o'clock. I'll be on telephone calls at 10 o'clock. This is like this is like Monday to Sunday. So, I just want to take a bit of time out, see what happens. I've had offers to buy the brand off me, and I've declined them. I don't need to sell it. But also, I'd like to... I like to get into property. That's what I want to do as well. I want to get into a bit of property, you know. I just want to get my hands dirty. Just get my hands dirty. Go into a property that I want to do up. So that's what I'm looking at the moment.
I'll give you 2 weeks before you say fuck this.
Do you know what? This is it, and I think I need that. I think I do need that. But I'm just going to enjoy my time at the moment.
What advice would you have to anyone that's thinking of starting a clothing brand?
Right now. I suppose the biggest thing I would say is how things have changed. I think community is so important now. I think building that community up. I think a lot of people are building brands up at the back of communities.
Mm-hmm.
I think people are thinking more advanced on how to build a brand, where I think they're building a community up, then launching a product off the back of it. You've got to look for what's the next big thing. You can't be jumping on a trend that's happening now. You know, you can't jump on that... You know, like graphics, that's been and gone. Performance wear is massive. It's too late. If you're thinking about doing that, it's too late. You've got to be on the next big trend. You've got to look to the US of where, you know, fashion's coming from. But also sad, look at the music scene, because obviously, you know, the back end of us with Foot Asylum, you know, the music scene dictates a lot of where the fashion goes.
Mm.
Where we're in sort of I think we're in a transition period with music.
100%.
And I think this is exactly the same with fashion. Fashion is a bit at the moment. And that's why I thought this is the right time to take the time out. And I've had other chats with other brand owners. This is the perfect time for me to take time out, where it's so, you know, the cost of living,
mm-hmm.
you know, the change of government, but also where fashion is at the moment. It's like that.
Yeah. I think music and fashion goes hand in hand. So obviously I can speak from my industry and say that everything just seems to be stagnant at the minute.
Yeah.
There's nothing exciting happening.
No.
There's nothing new coming out. There's no new trend.
No.
Everyone wants the quick bag.
Yeah.
Nobody wants to put work in.
No.
Nobody wants to invest.
No.
There's so many elements as to why I think it's so stagnant at the minute.
Yeah.
Social media being another big one. We're so very fast paced and we don't pay attention long term.
No.
Everything's fast, 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 fast.
Yeah.
Which is obviously another reason why people want fast money.
Yeah.
I'd agree with you completely. You've landed quite nicely on your time off.
Yeah, I think it's perfect. And I've said this and had a conversation with a few people and I went, give me a year. I hope it don't fall into two, but I said, just give me a bit more time out. And I think this is the perfect, what's going on now is the perfect time to do it. I don't think this is a great time to be launching a brand, but then they say, do you know what? If it's not the best time, maybe it is the best time.
Yeah, so, if you can find the gap.
Yeah, if you can find the gap. Yeah, because I think we've gone through the whole process where the grime scene being massive and brands have done so well, you know, with that. We've gone through, obviously, a lot of this clean sort of fashion as well. And now we're sort of moving into, you know, like gym wear, performance wear. Do you know what I mean? So, but I just think it's sort of, it's waiting for something to happen. Mm. And I don't know what it is.
I don't think we'll know till we see it.
No, no.
Something's going
to
happen.
But you need to be, I know. And I suppose this is where if I had the hunger and drive, I'd be knowing now. Yeah. If you'd have turned the clock 7 years back, yeah. And I think that's what it comes down to as well. I think you've got to have the hunger and drive. And I think I had that at the start. And that's what I need to go back and find, really.
I think time out will make you find it.
Definitely. Yeah. Oh, God, definitely.
You'll get bored. You'll think, oh.
Oh, I know.
Okay. You can, you'll take a month off and then you'll think, need to do something now.
Oh, I know, yeah. I'm finding it nice just not looking at social media and stuff like that and seeing what's happening, what's the next thing.
Yeah.
Next best thing is, so yeah. But yeah, I do think hand-in-hand music. So whenever you hear about what's happening,
I'll give you a call.
Yeah, give me a nod, yeah.
And whenever you hear about something, yeah, you give me a call. Yeah. And then me and you will be at the forefront of the
new
wave.
That's it.
Brilliant. Anything you want to finish up on?
No, not at all. No, just thanks, obviously, for inviting me in today. And this is probably the first time I've probably, well, it, this is the first time I've spoke really about the journey. So, yeah, no, appreciate it.
It's been a pleasure having you.
No,
bro.
It's been good.
Everything that I expected from this convo,
really?
I got. So, yeah, it's been amazing. And I've really enjoyed picking your brain.
No, brilliant.
And now I'm going to go and look at opening a clothing brand.
No, good. Good luck.
I'm going to go and find the next thing.
Yeah, that's it.
No, I'm joking. Thank you very much for coming, bro. I really appreciate it.
No, brilliant.
Thank you for watching at home. Haven't already, like and subscribe and look out for what's next from Mr. Pre, also known as Ash. And we'll see you again soon.
No, cheers. Thank you.